So thank you very much indeed for taking part in the Blue Collar Conservatism Conference and answering our questions, questions that have come from the public, questions that have come whilst we've been out in West Yorkshire. And the first one really is, what are we doing to stop the flow of asylum seekers coming over from France when that is a safe country?
Well, Esther, you're absolutely right. And first of all, let me just start by thanking Blue Collar Conservatives for all the work that you're doing for our party, but actually across the country. And this is a really important issue around asylum seekers, but illegal migration. Illegal migration is something that has plagued our country and other countries for well over 20 years. But let's not forget, when we go back to 2015, we saw the mass movement of people around the world because of great instability, obviously, in the Middle East. Now, what we have seen, though, are big flows of people travelling through the EU. EU countries where, of course, there are Schengen open borders. Now, first of all, of course, through the legislation we've brought in place in the UK, we're ending free movement, and that is a very significant step. But that doesn't address illegal migration. So when it comes to illegal migration, our measures are based on law enforcement. They're based on working with our intelligence and security agencies. And I've already said today we've had hundreds of arrests with organised immigration gangs, organised immigration criminals and associates, the people that are facilitators. They are people trafficking and they are responsible for illegal migration and smuggling people into the UK, mainly through small boats, because as we know, because of juxtaposed controls and also because of lorry drop. So, you know, in the past, illegal migrants would be smuggled on a much more frequent basis into lorries. Post that awful, awful incident in Purfleet last year, we have now really tightened up border checks on lorries. We had a very strong period where we were actually opening refrigerated lorries, going in with full enforcement powers to do much more at the border. But of course now, when it comes to small boats, that is all about upstream work, because it's too late when people are in the water, it's too late when people come to the UK. This is all about our near borders and our near neighbours and how we work with them. And we have a lot of work taking place with France, Belgium, Germany, the Netherlands, and we are also removing individuals who've come to our country by small boats. We are sending them to the EU country where we have data on them that they've travelled through certain EU countries, because the European Union, EU countries are safe countries. They're all signatories to the European Convention on Human Rights, and it's right that we return people back to those countries where we've got that data and information on where people have travelled through.
And I think people aren't seeing that. They're not seeing the people who are returned, or maybe even the battles you have to get people returned. So what, I mean, can you tell us some of the numbers, what's happening?
So far, well, first of all, we have two flights a week on a weekly basis returning individuals that have arrived to our country this year alone through small boats. So far, we have returned 210 people. We have 1,000 people where we have Eurodac information, where we are actively working with the European countries to return them. But of course, there are endless legal barriers. First of all, other EU member states are not proactive when it comes to responding to our requests to remove people under the Dublin regulation. So we have EU member states themselves not following the European Union Dublin regulations and not taking back people that, you know, have been deemed to be found coming through those countries in the first place. There's a lot of work that's taking place there. That's not just the Home Office, that's with the Foreign and Commonwealth Office as well. And then, of course, there are legal frustrations that we have. So last minute appeals that come through, literally as we are putting people on planes to remove them, through lawyers, through various immigration tribunals, people trying to exhaust all their rights through endless appeal rights. Now, in slower time and in the long term, of course, we will change the policy, we will change legislation, and that is something that I'm committed to. We've said this publicly. But right now, the priority is obviously when it comes to removals, making sure that those individuals that have travelled through EU member states are safe countries, that we can return individuals to those countries and they can claim asylum in those EU member states because they're safe countries and those countries have functioning asylum systems.
And you'll know and you'll be fully aware that people are upset when for asylum seekers are here, and they're being put up in nice hotels, hotels that residents of the UK couldn't afford. So what are we going to do about stopping that?
Well, first of all, when it comes to accommodation and hotels, that was a temporary short-term policy because of COVID. Now, back in March, when COVID obviously had a devastating impact across our country and the country was shut down, all aspects of the state, so the prison population, including asylum seekers, but also, you know, we did a lot for homeless individuals as well to make sure they were being housed. Everybody had to be accommodated in light of and in line with Public Health England guidance, and obviously in our case we also had to ensure that we were not going to be legally challenged by the courts around COVID restrictions and the applications. So the temporary policy was to place people into certain accommodations so they could have individual rooms such as hotels. We have now changed the policy, and it's important that I say that because that was a short-term policy. We are now moving back into the system in a phased way where we can start to remove people who've exhausted all their appeal rights, because of course they too were being housed in a COVID compliant way because of COVID regulations and guidance, because we were not allowed to remove people from the country. So the removals are taking place. That's one aspect. We're removing people from temporary accommodation back into, in a phased way, back into the community in COVID compliant accommodation. But it is also a fact that I'm using government estate, military areas where simply they are not being used by our armed forces, to ensure that we can put people in those forms of accommodation in a COVID compliant way, particularly now we've got more measures, COVID restrictions that have been put in place, while at the same time we go through their claims to see if they are admissible claims. If they are inadmissible claims, then clearly we will be returning those individuals to countries where they have travelled through, as I've outlined, predominantly EU member states, because small boat people have obviously been coming through the European Union.
And as we leave the EU, what are we going to do to make sure that we reduce immigration numbers?
Well, first and foremost, on illegal migration, there is work that we need to do. There is fundamental reform that is required to our asylum system. Our asylum system has not changed in legislation for many, many years, decades in fact. So there are policy changes that we are working on right now that will become legislative changes. So I think it's important just to outline that. But also when it comes to legal migration, first of all, we are ending free movement. That is our commitment. That was our commitment to the British public. That was associated with Brexit. Brexit is done. So we're now at the stage of looking towards the end of transition. We will have a points-based immigration system that will come into place on the 1st of January. That points-based immigration system will do what it says on the tin. It will appeal to the brightest and the best. We've got a global talent route. This will be for employers to sponsor individuals to come to the UK to work. We are already testing those routes. We've put in a lot of measures right now. You'll be aware that legislation is going through the House of Lords, it's gone through the House of Commons, and that'll be one of the most significant changes delivered by this Conservative government in less than a year since the election in December, that will very much speak to our commitment to bring about the change that we promised the British public when it comes to taking back control.
And at the weekend we saw the murder of a police officer. What are we going to do to make sure that anybody who does such an act really does serve a suitable sentence? What are we going to do to increase the sentence for killing a police officer?
So we saw on Friday the most abhorrent crime, and Sergeant Matt Ratner was an absolute hero, and we will never forget him and his service to the Metropolitan Police, but also to his community and his country. In terms of police protection, we are totally committed to ensuring that we bring in a police covenant. I announced that a year ago, in fact, and of course we made that abundantly clear in the manifesto in December. But a police covenant is just one step forward in terms of enshrining in law, you know, the support that we will give to the welfare and the safety and security of our police officers. It's right that we do that, but also we broaden that to their family members. The family members of our police officers go through such trauma on a daily basis, as we know, with assaults on police officers. Last year alone, there were 30,000 assaults on police officers, which is completely unacceptable. But we are also committed through the sentencing bill that will come forward to doubling the sentences to those individuals that perpetrate crimes against our emergency workers, and that also includes our police officers. That is a commitment that we are absolutely dedicated to, and legislation is going to be forthcoming on that, alongside the work that we are going to do to enshrine the police covenant into law. In the last 12 months, we have re-established the Conservative Party as a party of law and order. And with that, you know, we speak about tougher sentencing of those that cause harm, perpetrate serious violence and criminality. It is sad to say that too much crime still takes place. But our commitment is obviously to reducing crime, and we're doing that obviously through more police officers and more investment in policing, but also going after the perpetrators of crime. In the last year alone, we've seen over 2,600 individuals arrested for peddling drugs across the United Kingdom. So we're going after the kingpins of criminality, of drug crime, of county lines in particular, and we've seen hundreds of county lines rolled up. So we're working with our police officers day in, day out. We're tooling them up. We're equipping them. We are investing. We are investing in police officers and policing every single day, and we will continue to do that. And that is central to our commitment as the party of law and order.
And I have to say, the drug issue and the county lines was brought up again and again as we went round the local communities. Mm. And then again in West Yorkshire, the issue that still remains again brought up, particularly in Keighley area, was the grooming.
That's
situation.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. So. What we have seen in recent years, obviously the horror, the absolute abhorrent horror of grooming gangs, there's just some incredible work that's been taking place, Esther, with the NCA in particular, on very targeted operations around the perpetrators of horrible, horrible sexual abuse and the abuse of young girls. We are, and I can at least give some assurance without given too much away, when it comes to the individuals, the perpetrators, it is right that they're going through the criminal justice process. Sentencing is taking place, but also we are speaking about individuals, sometimes of dual nationality, and looking at how we can absolutely make sure that, you know, people are served notice, deported for their crimes. I'm afraid in the past not enough of that activity has taken place. And we're also working in the Home Office and across with the MOJ as well, the Ministry of Justice, to ensure that justice is given to the victims and therefore individuals are given the right sentences, but also when it comes to making sure the victims are protected, that the right kind of protection orders through local policing, through local police forces, are also being put in place to protect the victims of those abhorrent crimes.